Showtime, man.
What's up, homie?
Hey, man, I've been thinking, man.
And you thinking about what?
Hey, I'm ready to get put down.
You ready
on
to get put down on this
you
set?
I'm ready to represent.
On this one right here?
Yes.
You ready to die for this?
I'm ready to die for this, nigga.
What you ready to do,
man? I'm ready to put in
what you
work.
Ready to do? You ready to get it? Yeah. Get it.
Pretty much been like a, you know, a pioneer when it came to like the West Coast culture, hip hop, you know, all the way from Cypress Hill, you know, doing a lot of photography, video, you know what I mean? So I just felt like, you know, your story needs to be told, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's why we're here today. So, yeah.
That's for sure.
Definitely. All right. So first question is, how did you get started in the business?
Well, I was always like, when I was a teenager, I was into skateboarding and listening to different kinds of music, like classic rock, like Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd, Jimi Hendrix, The Doors, Janis Joplin, to listening to punk rock, like, you know, The Clash, Sex Pistols, Dead Kennedys, that kind of stuff, to the hip hop, you know, which was Grandmaster Flash and you know, all the first hip hop that came out. We would make our own tapes, and like when you were a teenager back then, like you can either go to a party or stay home and listen to like the Uncle Jam's Army mix on 1580 KDAY. We only had hip-hop on AM radio. So if people were going to a party, I was like, oh, that sounds whack, you know? I would just stay home and tape that. And it was like the Saturday Night Jam, which was like a four-hour mix. So I would get like either 4 1-hour tapes, and I would just tape it straight through because there was like no commercials. So you hear all of Uncle Jam's Army, you know, mixing like old school, like at that time it was just like New York hip hop, and it was new and fresh, and it was like, it was cool, you know. We were like, man, this is crazy, you know, because, you know, we're used to like, you know, rock or punk rock or like pop music, you know, back then, which was like Madonna and stuff like that had just come out. Beastie Boys were even punk rock. Like, I saw Madonna, I think, in 1983 or 84 in, I think it was San Diego, at the Balboa Stadium over there. And Madonna was a headliner, and Beastie Boys opened up for her, and they were doing punk rock.
Okay.
They weren't even doing hip hop. So, like, that's how far, you know, I go back with hip hop. Then I was always going to clubs. When I was 16, I used to have these two pencils that I would use, and I would fake a 6 into a 0 so I could get in all the clubs, like on my birth year.
Okay.
Instead of 66, I would like the number was like this,
right.
So I would block this out with a like a yellowish cream color pencil. And then I took like a perfectly colored pencil that matched the black on the thing, and I would just make it a circle. So it
like
said 60 instead of 66.
Okay, so you added 6 years.
So I'd go all the way, and I'd go in the clubs, you know? I added 4 years, right?
Or
6 years, yeah, 6 years. So I added, you know, an extra 6 years on me, and I'd go into all the clubs.
Okay.
And it was like an official ID, so they wouldn't trip. They'd be like, they wouldn't think that this kid was over here doing that? Like one tiny little line, I could, you know, fake right. my way into a club.
Right.
And we would try and dress older and look, you know, like wear like a jacket, you know, like right. a button, you know, suit type of jacket. Then when the whole hip hop thing came out, we started going to the hip hop clubs. So I'd been around the clubs, you know, for all these years before I was even 21 years old. And in my early mid 20s, I started working at clubs, doing the door, the VIP, you know, section, you know, the guest list, all that kind of stuff. And I met everybody in the hip hop scene back then. I met Ice-T, Donald D, Evil E, Henji, you know, all the Everlast, all the Rhyme Syndicate, Red Hot Chili Peppers. They were big in the clubs there. They used to play like Coconut Teaser on Crescent Heights and Sunset. There was a Fishbone, Cypress Hill, they were like 17, 18 years old. And Booyah Tribe, all these different LA-based groups I met working at the doors of the club. So I became cool with, you know, the guys from Cypress. I met them in 1989. So in around 1992, Muggs goes, "Hey homie, you wanna work with us?" You know, and I was like, "Oh hell yeah," cause you know, Cypress had been out for a year and they were blowing up, and I was like, man, this is gonna be the shit, you know, I'm thinking in my head. And then he goes, "It's not for Cypress though, it's for a new group I have, some white boys." And I go, "Oh, fuck." Because at that time, Vanilla Ice was real big, and I was thinking, like, you know, who's he gonna tell me now? Mm-hmm. And he goes, "You know Everlast, right?" I go, "Oh, hell yeah, that's the homie." He goes, "He's coming out with a new group called House of Pain." And I was like, "Oh, cool." That's who I want you to work with. I go, "Oh, that's perfect," you know?
Right.
So me, Everlast, and Muggs met up. We chopped it up, and next thing you know, I was on the road with, you know, House of Pain being a tour manager. And I told my bosses, you know, at that time I was doing construction during the day and I was working the clubs at night.
Okay.
And I told my bosses, "Hey, is it cool if I go do this job and then come back and you know, and have my job back?" And they go, "Oh yeah, for sure," you know, because both of them said I was their best worker, you know. I was the first one there, the last one to leave. And that's kind of how, what you need to be like when you're doing a tour managing, right? You got to be up before the band, you got to go to bed after they go to bed, you know, because you got to wake up and get them going, and you got to make sure that everybody's back home safe in the nighttime, you know. So because, you know, the next every second counts when you're on the road, you know. If somebody goes to some girl's house and stays there and forgets to wake up, then they hold up the whole bus and we're all late for the next show. So we always had to keep it tight. And I worked with House of Pain 92 93 94, and then they broke up. And then I went on tour with at that time the tour manager for Cypress Hill was acting shady, and they go, "Hey man, you know, would you want to come out with us? You know, we're going to cut Homeboy loose." I go, "Yeah, hell yeah. What do you want to do?" And they go, "Okay, your first, you know, show to make sure you can, you know, hang is Woodstock." So I went to Woodstock in 1994, and they were like, "Okay, you know, you get the job." So I went with Cypress from 94 to 2005, and then they kind of, you know, slacked off on touring. So then I started shooting pictures and in the early 90s, and I learned how to hustle that scene and get jobs like that. So around 2005, I was like, I'm not making it just tour managing only Cypress Hill when they don't want to tour no more. So I got to figure out a new hustle, whether it's tour manage other bands or do photography. So I was learning, you know, photography, like the industry a little bit better, and I was thinking, I'm gonna go with this, you know?
Right.
So I knew both of them, you know, I knew how to take pictures, I knew how to tour manage, but I just figured I didn't want to be on the road with a bunch of weird people I didn't know,
right.
You know? So I just chose the photography, and, you know, the rest is history.
Nice. Who and or what were some of your influences coming up that helped shape your creative vision?
I would say my dad is pretty much, he always brought, like, my mom and dad divorced when I was 3, so I'd only see my dad, like, summer times or holidays. But he always took me around, like, nature and art. Like, if we weren't going to the beach, we were going to the mountains, going hiking. If we weren't doing that, we were going to, like, a museum or an art show. So it's kind of like, you know, messed up for my mom because, you know, she was the one who had to be the parent. And then I would just, like, go do the cool stuff with my dad, you know?
Okay.
So he always had me around art and stuff like that. So I would say, you know, it's pretty much him that made me, you know, into what I am, you know, other than me, you know?
Right.
But, yeah, I was around, you know, because he was shooting in the 80s and stuff like that, so I'd say his photography probably had the biggest impact on me. And okay. Then, you know, like the big pros, you know, like Avedon and Herb Brits and Bruce Weber and all the big, you know, Peter Lindbergh and Patrick okay. Demarchelier, like all the big famous photographers back then.
Okay.
And then I, you know, got into like Nan Golden and Diane Arbus, Araki, Dairo Maruyama, and you know, I just would see, I started picking up photography books, you know, because I didn't really like reading.
Right.
So I thought, you know, if I'm going to look at a book, I just want to look at pictures, mm-hmm. good ones, you know. So
right.
Most of the pictures that were shot in the street, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, if you say street photographer, it's got, it has to be like gangsters or something like that. But
mm-hmm.
back then, it was just everybody shot, like, just out in the street. It was no big deal, you know, like in Europe or wherever. Like, people would just walk around and take cool pictures. Like, nowadays, like, people will freak out if, like, if somebody busts out a camera,
right?
Especially here in LA, if you bust out a camera, people are like, "Hey, what's that picture for? Wait, mm-hmm. why are you taking pictures? You know,
right.
do you have a permit or mm-hmm. all kinds of, you know, from everybody that you would see in the street, they all want to know why you're taking pictures. Mm-hmm. Whether it's like a normal guy, you know, they all there's a suspicion."
Right.
Here in LA about people taking pictures, like mm-hmm. why you taking a picture? You can't just be like, I just am taking a cool
just
picture.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, why?
Mm-hmm.
Are you a cop? Are you a, you know, are you looking to, are you taking pictures so you can come back and rob the place later, you know, mm-hmm. like you know, you're plotting and scheming.
Right.
Are you you know, making money at it? Is it for a job and you're shooting this in this area and you know you're making money, I need to make some money
mm-hmm.
to shoot in front of my house, or like there's a building over here
mm-hmm.
downtown and I was shooting somebody against the brick wall and this guy comes out and goes, "Hey," and I'm like, "Yeah." He goes, "What are you shooting?" "I'm shooting a picture of this guy." "Why?" He goes, "This is my building, we make money, you know, off of shoots and stuff." I go, "Yeah, I'm probably do inside, but not out here." He goes, "Yeah, the whole building." I go, "I'm on the sidewalk, man. You can't get nothing out of me,
mm-hmm.
you know? I'm just on the sidewalk taking a picture of my friend, and we're not doing a big production shoot, so, you know, save that for somebody else." And he got all pissed off and, like, act like he was going to go call the cops or something like that, but,
mm-hmm.
you know. Okay.
Right.
What was the question?
So what, like now, what inspires and motivates you?
It's different shit that I see, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, pretty much, like, I have, like, a certain type of stuff that I shoot. So if it's something cool in one of that fits in one of those genres, then I'd like to shoot it, you know. Like, I like to shoot graffiti, but I like shooting like kind of like hood graffiti instead of like the real bright colors and real like big pieces of work. I just like shooting letters, like black and white, plain and simple,
okay,
letters. And people are always telling me, hey, there's this big, you know, block letters or big Picasso over here or there. And I go and it's like painted over, or I go and check it out and it's not that good.
Right.
Like, I like good technique, you know? And today I found one. It was pretty cool. So okay, I went over and shot it, but it was half in the shade, half in the sun, so I'm gonna have to go back another time when it's like overcast, so it's all equal lit,
right,
so that it looks cool.
Okay.
And then, you know, if I see a girl that's, you know, cute, I'll see if she wants to do a shoot, because I'm doing another LA woman book.
Okay.
So I try to, you know, always find new talent for that. And then jobs, you know, inspire me a lot, because I have a lot of bills.
Right.
And if I can get a job that'll help me take care of those, man, that'd be great. So, you know, especially since, like, before it was easy because I had the Cypress Hill money, you know, to fall back on.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's just me and my camera, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot has changed since I made that change. Like, there's like 80% less magazines. You know, I noticed this magazine, like, you know, this was a big magazine. For, I always used to look at it because of, you know, Cypress and stuff, so we'd always be checking, like, you know, who's a new group coming out,
mm-hmm,
and who's in the charts. And I don't know if this one had charts.
I'm
pretty sure it might have had something.
They may have had some stuff, but yeah, like you said, like that magazine.
But we, but like, you know, there was always like the, yeah, see, it has like album
right,
critiques, you know, and
right, reviews.
Like, we'd always check, oh, what they say about so and so, what they say about so and so. So, you know, I was always a big fan of magazines. So now there's like 80% magazines are cut, you know, they're gone. And then I'd say about 70 to 80% of the budgets for album packaging or album shoots is gone too. And video shoots are cut, like the budget video shoot budgets are way low. I went today to meet a video rep that gets you jobs as a video director. And I told him, hey, what kind of budgets are coming through? You know, back in the day, like the Hype Williams and, you know, shooting Missy Elliott or something like that, Puff Daddy, they were $1 million budgets. So, and the set budget for a video director was 20%. So you were getting $200,000 if you got a $1 million video, you know, which is cool, you know. You're over there doing like a $1 million thing. You know, $200,000 for a couple of days ain't bad. You know, who knows how many of those you get a year. You know, it's not like what everybody thinks, you know. You might get 4 videos that you see on MTV a lot, but that's for the whole year. And that shit, you know, goes quick when you start getting new stuff. You know, the money just flies out the door. I never got that, you know, that level, but the video budgets now, they're saying, like today she told me, like a Katy Perry video will get like 150,000 to 200,000, as opposed to 10 years ago was getting like $1 million.
Right.
So with that, you can kind of figure out how much, you know, less people are making behind the scenes, you know. That's like, you know, 80-90% of a drop in income. So that forces you to, it forces like the guys, the A-listers, the photographers, to come down to the next level to try to, you know, punk the like the B-listers out of those jobs. Because there's not so many, and they're not paying as much, so they gotta like come down, and that forces these guys to come down, and everybody at the bottom is just doing shit free, just to be seen, or to get a name. And that's cool, you're getting a name, but you're working for free. Sometimes you have to, you know, like if you wanna, like this magazine, if you want to be in a magazine like this, like look at the difference. Mm-hmm. No disrespect to, you know, right. Good old Music Connection. But you see the paper here and the thickness. Mm-hmm. You know, like this is like this is an information magazine. This is an art magazine. Like the paper mm-hmm. is real thick. And like, you know, there's like mostly like full page layouts, not too much advertising, hardly any at all. I don't even know if there is any. Yeah, I don't see none. But it's cool to be in a magazine like this. Mm-hmm. So this kind of magazine, if they call you up and they're like, hey, do you have a photo for our magazine? You know, there's no budget, but you know, it's the basketball issue. Do you want to be a part of it? It's kind of like contributing to like an art book, you know. That's what they always say, you know, it's a good look, you know. So this kind of stuff, it's a good look to be in. But any old, you know, just any old magazine, no, it's not a good look, you know, because no one's ever called me and goes, hey man, I seen your shit in this magazine. Mm-hmm. I want to give you this job. You know, it's mm-hmm. gonna pay like 10 grand.
Right.
You know, that's never happened. Right. It's like a accumulation of all the work, of all the names, of, you know, the album covers, the videos, like everything brings the attention to them for me to be up for the job. Mm-hmm. But then I gotta like convince them to. Why out of the 100,000 photographers in the world, why do you have to pick me? And why, after you pick me, why do you have to pay this price? You know, it's like you can pick, you know, the Estevan Oriol Jr. out there walking around, and have him do it for cheap or free, and he'll just emulate my style. Why pay me? Why, you know, why would you? What you want? You want to have me, you know, promoting it. You want to have me, you know, claiming the shoot. You know. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like, it's weird now. It's like, before you just would shoot a job, get the check, which were good, and they put your name in the corner, like your name would be like here, mm-hmm. small little type letters. Like that was it. Now it's like, oh, you want the job? Okay, it's like 90% less than what you used to get paid. And if we get Twitter, mm-hmm. make a behind the scenes video of the shoot and put that on your YouTube channel and put it on Vimeo. Like, they get all that on top of their photo shoot. Mm-hmm. You're like, and you get paid less, 90%.
Right.
So it's like, you know, my advice to all you youngsters out there, if you really want to be a photographer, come on with it. And there's not too much going on. So you could be famous and cool and big on Instagram or Facebook, mm-hmm. but I don't know how much of your bills you'll be paying with it, you know?
Right.
For me, all this shit, I paid for, these are all prints, every one of these boxes is full of prints that I paid for, you know, from the money that I was making with Cypress Hill. So like I would have like my apartment was like $400 in Hollywood. I lived off of like Highland and Melrose.
Okay.
It was $400. I had my bed, a fish tank with like some piranhas in it, and my turntables. And then there was a windows, and I had a bathroom and a closet and a kitchen. No bedroom. It's $400 a month. And I just would use my money that I made off of that to make photos and pay for all the film.
Right.
And that was, you know, that was how you become a photographer back then. Mm-hmm. You know, now you have to you had to pay top dollar to get a camera. Like you couldn't go into Best Buy, give them your credit card and get a $3,000 camera that's like top of the line, like a Canon 5D. Mm-hmm. Start taking pictures. Like you had to go buy a camera, buy a bunch of film, and keep shooting film until you got good. And then you had to make prints to show people. And then you had to get an appointment with somebody, or, you know, this is before there was phones, mm-hmm. cell phones, there was emails, all that shit. We had pagers and we had faxes and phones that you would dial up, mm-hmm. or go to the payphone and put change in. And you'd be making appointments with people. And then you go show them your pictures and you had to have like a presentation. And now it's just like, you know, hey, check me out on Instagram, or, you know, look at my website.
Right.
You know, it wasn't like that when I started.
Right.
So I invested a lot of money, mm-hmm. you know, all the money I was making on the road into this.
Right.
And I'm kind of glad though that that's how I came into it.
Right.
Like that, I'm happy that that's how I learned about photography. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the way I learned it. You know, just, you know, film, like, You could either have like this and this. Like, you could have all this here and this. Like some people think, oh, why do I want all that shit? You can have all this. Or you could have this. Shit. And this equals this. To me, this is way cooler. All this stuff. Way cooler than this. But, or you could have this right here, or those 10 file cabinets full of negatives. I mean, this is cool, it's cute, it looks designer. So, you know, real stealth looking, arty-farty, black, and it holds a shitload of stuff. You know, a little small area, but I'd rather be able to like go to a file and look through it, pull it out. Mm-hmm. Like, I like all that shit.
Right.
But maybe that's just old fashioned or something. I don't know.
Gotcha. All right. So that actually leads me to my next question. What do you think makes for a good photographer and good director?
Someone that has their own style, and someone that can either be creative with the concept and idea before they get there, or someone that can make some shit happen out of nothing. You know, like, that's me. I might not be the most creative guy, like, can think of some crazy wild setup, but I can go somewhere and make something come out of nothing. Like, people are like, how did you get that from that, you know? I don't even know. You know, I just go there and I, like that basketball book, you know? When I got to New York to shoot I wanted to shoot outdoor basketball in New York. I thought it was gonna be live and cracking like those games that they show on the TV and stuff. And I get there, there's not one person on any of the basketball courts, and I only had one day there to shoot. So I go, oh man. And then I was thinking about it, I was like, you know what? That's kind of cool, you know? Like, everybody's used to seeing the Rutgers games going on, like, you know, wild and loud and crazy and all this mad energy going on in New York and the city and the basketball courts. But on the day I'm here, there's not one bird. There wasn't even a bird on the court, you know? So I was like, this is kind of cool. So I shot all that. I shot all the empty courts. So it's like I made something out of nothing, you know?
Right.
There's nothing there, but it's, in a way, to me, it looked, you know, cool.
Definitely. Okay. So speaking about your camera, what kind of camera do you use?
This one. Right here. Okay. And,
what's up?
Huh?
There's like some hippies in the parking spot right there, like drinking beer, cartoons parking spot.
Tell them they gotta go.
Okay.
It's in the... We're not in the H Street. There's my camera, and these are my two lenses that I use.
What kind of camera is that?
It's a Canon 81. And there's a 28 millimeter lens. And this is a 35 to 70.
So you use that for photo stills and like to direct movies?
No.
No?
This is just stills.
Okay.
And then I use a 5D for filming.
Okay.
No, this was this guy that he used to go to my gas station every time.
Okay.
He was from Cuba. And I'd trip out on him because he was born with no hands. And he would clean cars every week. So every Sunday I'd go and give him some money. Okay. And then like during Christmas time I'd give him clothes. His wife had like a brain tumor. She was in the hospital and he had three kids. And he'd go and he could wash your car. He would like hold the bottle and then he'd hit it like that with his hand.
Okay.
And then he'd wipe it down. I just felt bad for the guy, you know?
Right, right.
But I just made friends with him. Like, I would just talk to him and go up and give him like a hug, you know? Because everybody else would be kind of like, he was a freak, you know? Like, fuck. Because there's like two bones here, and his arm just had one bone and the thumb. So like he didn't have this bone and none of this part of his hand.
Okay.
So he would just have this, like this. Wow. I'd just trip out on him. I'd be like, man. Every time I'd feel like I thought I had some fucking bullshit problem, I'd just go kick my homeboy for like an hour.
Right.
Just be like, ain't no fucking problems here.
Right,
everything
right.
is cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was a... This is one of my favorite shots.
Okay. Yeah, I remember.
That I've done. Yeah, so this is my, these are my two like, weapons of choice or whatever they call it. It's like, this is my still camera, and this is my favorite film camera.
Okay.
This is a 35 millimeter still, and this is the 16 millimeter. Screw the lenses on there and you got some bomb ass footage.
Nice. Okay. So if you had to choose one of your favorite photographs and music videos that you directed, which one would it be and why?
I would say my favorite, probably my favorite music video, I would say, is Down from Blink-182, because they said just do whatever you want, and they like gave me a budget, and that was my biggest budget, and I didn't do anything what the song was about or anything, and I just filmed something that I wanted to film. We had helicopters and all kinds of shit flying through the river and a police chase, and to me it was just fun. Like, they just gave me an amount of money and told me to do whatever I want. So that was fun. And then I guess I'd say my favorite picture, because it's gotten me the most, you know, love everywhere, is the LA Fingers photo. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Which is,
you got it right there behind you, too.
This one.
Right.
This is like my most copied picture worldwide.
Right.
Like, every clothing company has done this, and they're like, oh, you didn't make up the LA sign or whatever. I'm like, hey, where were you in 1994 when I took that?
Mm-hmm.
You were, you know, they're over here rolling around like, in Silver Lake with their hair part on the side with beards and tattoos just on their hands, talking about, you know, you don't own the LA sign. I'm like, come on, man. The people that were doing this back then, 1994, they were nowhere over there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in those, in the safe zone, you know?
Right.
They were, it was a hood only thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I never seen a picture of it back then.
Right.
Not one. Mm-hmm. 1994, you know?
Yes.
So, all these, you know, people that are in their 20s or 30s talking about, about, all right, whatever.
Right.
So that's why I put it on the cover of my book, to kind of like put it to rest, you know?
Right. Like, so you know where it started from.
Yeah.
It originated.
Who's daddy, you know? So.
Mm-hmm.
It's the number one most bootlegged photo I've ever taken. Mm-hmm. And even like clothing companies have bootlegged the shit out of it. Like Givenchy, you know, did this like corny house and like a flag behind it with like an LA like square picture down here.
Mm-hmm.
Then H&M got one of the, you know, designers, you know, some white guy with some weird tattoos on his hands, and you know, he's throwing up LA like all like
crooked.
Yeah. And then they made a T-shirt out of it, and I tried to sue him, you know, because I was like, this is getting ridiculous. Like, I don't mind all the little hood, you know, everybody trying. We all, there's enough money for all the, you know, everybody trying to do their thing, but, you know, goddamn, like, when you're just in there, like, Brandy Melville or fucking Forever 21 or H&M,
right,
that ain't never stepped a fucking foot in no hood in L.A.,
yeah,
anywhere in L.A., East L.A., West L.A., South Central, the Valley, whatever, and they're over here fucking doing that shit is, like, crazy to me, you know?
Commercializing it.
Yeah, like, it's cool, like, you know, even the old man, the little old viejito that does the Dodger games, like, it's funny, you know, it's cute, it's funny, but he's not H&M either, you know, trying to, you know, like, I went into a PacSun store, and they had a shirt that said, "Bitch, don't kill my vibe." Gangsta Rap made me do it. The LA Fingers, like this, like,
right,
fucking 10 shirts of all of our like culture here, and it's in the mall. And I'm like thinking, like,
they know nothing about that.
That shit was crazy, you know? I called Kendrick's manager, and I go, I don't know if you guys got that fucking name trademarked or whatever, but they're killing it at PacSun with that shit. Mm. Like, people get clothing twisted too. Like, some of these clothing lines are, like when Sean John and Rockaware was at its biggest, they were shipping 300, 400 million a year in clothing. I don't think they were selling that much in records a year.
Right.
You know, so, you know, the level that the clothing game could take you is pretty big, you know? And that's why we started Joker Clothing back in the day, 1995. We're right now in 2014. When we came out with Joker brand, there wasn't even a section in the shows called streetwear. Okay. It was called, I don't even remember what it was called. I don't have the best memory because I was with Cypress Hill for 10 years, you know? And I think maybe all the weed they smoked might have, you know, helped my memory go in different places. But the good thing is I have all these pictures to remember everything. Like, I trip out when I see a bunch of my pictures. I'm like, damn, look at, I forgot all about that. And I start getting nervous that if I'm getting Alzheimer's or some shit. How about this?
That's what's up.
Went from this. Well, first we went from this. Okay. My mom, rest in peace. She died on at Christmas time last year. To this, 1994. To this. Who would ever thought?
How's it like working with them?
Well, cool. Like, I could go work at Home Depot or something and be cool. Fuck it, I shop Robert De Niro and Al Pacino.
My favorites.
With the crazy thing is, I took this and I was there shooting it, and I was like this going, like, Al Pacino's right there going, hey, what are we gonna do? What do you want to do? Yeah, what are we gonna do here? And I go, hold on right there, hold on. And he's moving around, so I'm going like fucking trying to get him. He's like, what are we gonna do? Hey, are we gonna shoot or what? I go, hold on, fuck. Hold on, I'm looking, what the fuck is wrong with it? But we were in Culver City all day, and it was cold as shit. These things got like overheated or like frozen. So luckily I had this Pentax 6-7, Big Bertha. I clicked that, I was like, I had two of these, I took two. I went and bought one. I was like, just in case, I'm gonna go buy another one in case some shit fucks up, I'll be safe. Pull that one out, I'm shooting, and I have like 20 huge movie executives behind me. I'm going like, okay, come on, buddy, let's go. Time, you're on the clock. And I'm like fucking panicking, going, fuck, these fucking cameras. I pulled out the second one that I just bought brand new. It worked perfect at the shop like 6 hours ago. I'm trying to shoot him, son of a bitch, man. And I said, man, if God or whatever, if anybody's watching me, like, you can kill me tomorrow, but please just let me have a camera that works right now. Like, don't do this to me right now. I've gone way too far. I pull out Big Bertha out of the bag and clicked it, and he goes, Al Pacino goes, man, I like that one. So this Big Bertha right here. I haven't used it in a while. The battery's like, yeah. Anyways, you can see the difference. So when you pull this shit out, you're getting some like props. You know, you're like, hey, you know, this dude's serious about his. You got that big old motherfucking thing. You look at it, and you're like, there's a big difference. You know, so. When I pulled this out and this thing just goes, it sounds like, you know, like almost like a gun going off. Al Pacino, he loved that shit. He's like, man, I like that one. So I'm sitting there like this, trying to shoot, and Al Pacino was like moving backwards and forwards, and Robert De Niro was like going side to side. So I'm trying to like follow them both around, in between they were talking like to different people, and like, you know, when two people are standing together, and one's going like back and forth, and the other one's going side to side, and they're talking and doing this shit, and both of them are blinking at different times. I was shitting myself that I would never, there's no way I'm gonna get this shot. And it was about 4.5 minutes into, from the time I picked up my small camera till the time they said, okay, that's it, thank you. And I was like, man, I shot, I think it was 15 shots, like 15 frames. And I was like, there's no way I got it, you know? And I was like bummed out, you know, but I remember if I clicked it 15 times, there was a reason, you know? Mm-hmm. Like I thought like I might have gotten something, but I was shitting myself. So I went to the photo lab, told them, hey, like I trust you guys and everything. You guys like do all my film, but today I gotta sit there and watch this. Like I have to watch you touch the film like the whole way. And they go, yeah, sure, what's wrong with you? I go, this is the most important role of my life. This one role. It's like, there's these that hold 36, and there's these that hold either 10 or 20. And I had two 10s. So I shot one of 10 and then half of one. And I go, I just gotta watch you guys process this role. They go, yeah, why? What's the big deal? I go, I kind of don't want to tell you because I don't want you to be nervous. Like, this is real important. Okay, man, whatever. You're one of our best customers. Like, whatever, we don't care. Stand right here. And I watched it all the way through, and as I saw it come through, I was like, oh, man, I got it. You know, like, I saw it. And then I called up my partners that I work with, and I go, hey, I got the shot. And they go, you got it? They go, yeah, I got it. Because it was a spec job. They had already had the movie poster done. Mm-hmm. They had already paid the guy and everything. And they go, oh, yeah, that's done. We just want you guys to do a skateboard. And we're like a collab skateboard with the movie. We're like, we want the movie poster. And they go, well, you can try, but, you know, I don't think it's, you know, you can do it for free, and if we use it, we'll pay you. Mm-hmm. But we can't pay you what we pay the other guy, because that was the budget for that already. Mm-hmm. We were like, we don't care. I just want to say that I shot Robert De Niro and Al Pacino, and Cartoon wanted to say that he had his artwork on there too. So like if you see, this is all me. Mm-hmm. This cartoon, all these letters were done by hand. Okay. And then the design was done by our other boy, Patrick Martinez, who's coming up real big right now in the art world. Okay. So this was it, SA Studios. Nice. And that was like one of the best days of my career.
Nice.
Here you go, brother.
Explain the Soul Assassins to us.
Soul Assassins was started in 1991 by DJ Muggs, and it was basically his like production, like music name, that, you know, of the crew, and then it House of Pain, and then Funk Dubious, and then me and Cartoon. And then it was just like, by the time it was, we came around, it was like, it was just gonna be like an artist family. And that was pretty much it. We closed the books right there, you know. It was like, you know, we had our little, we had music on lock, We had film and photography. We had clothing. And we had every other kind of art through cartoon. Because he could tattoo, airbrush, paint, draw, engrave. Like he can do art on any type of canvas, like metal, wood, skin, paper, whatever, glass, anything. So we felt like we pretty much had it all covered, and each of us could carry our own weight in what we did. So we're like, that's it, we got this, you know? And we all like started just working as like one big machine until everybody got so busy, like everybody just had to, you know, do their own thing. And now it's like we all work together on different projects, you know, like sometimes I'll do something with mugs, sometimes I'll do something with B-reel, sometimes I'll do something with cartoon, or you know, everybody would switch up. But it wasn't like how it was when we first started, where we only all did everybody's shit, our own shit. Like at first we just came out like this, and then we just all like split up, but we're all, you know, still everybody's, you know, still cool. We're all family, but it just everybody like got was getting hit up to do so many different things, you know. The cartoon couldn't just be Cypress Hill's tattoo artist no more. I couldn't just be, you know, Cypress Hill's photographer, video director anymore. Mugs couldn't just make music for Cypress Hill. And B couldn't just rap. You know, he does his radio show, he does, you know, B-Real, he does Cypress Hill. You know, everybody's, you know, trying to do, you know, as much as we can. It's like once you start doing stuff and you start getting recognized and you start doing cool stuff, you either like it and love it, or you hate it and you go, you don't do it anymore. So we all like it and love it. Like I didn't, out of all these rolls of film, right here that you see, there's all these, right? I go on the Gumball, and my thing is to shoot and video it, but the rest of the stuff, Gumball's about 7 of these rolls, out of like 20, the other 13 I did just because I love it. And it wasn't for a job. So I didn't just do it free, I paid for it all. I bought the film, I bought the proof sheets and all that, and it was for nothing. So there was no reason that I went out and shot all this stuff. Like it wasn't for, hey, can you go shoot this for me, or go shoot that for me. It was just me loving what I do. You know, it doesn't go too good, you know, with the wife, you know, or the family. They see it as, you know, you're wasting money on all that stuff for what, you know? But I love it, you know, I like doing it, and you know, I'll do something with it somewhere, somehow,
right,
down the line, just like I did with the rest of the stuff. I didn't do that for anything either.
Right.
I wasn't doing it for a reason. I wasn't doing it for money. But I ended up, you know, that's the stuff that I got known for. All those magazines right there were in all those against that wall. Mirror cartooners in every one of those.
Nice.
Except the Teen Angels.
All right, so tell us about Sanction TV.
Extinction TV was a channel that we wanted to do to promote things that we liked, that we did like a channel with Makers TV. Mm-hmm. And basically they give you like a little production money that you have to recoup if mm-hmm. anything ever happens with the channel. Mm-hmm. So I did 52 videos, got over 1 million views, and my contract was like 220 minutes. Mm-hmm. And I did the 220 minutes. It came out through the 52 videos. We got 12,000 subscribers, over 1 million views. The contract's up, and that's that. But I got to make 52 videos and had fun doing it.
Okay.
But that was about the three shows that we had on our channel. The series were LA Woman. Hey, what's it like shooting those girls and all that? Can I hold your lights and shit like that? And man, if they only knew, you know. Mm-hmm. Like I hear weird, crazy stories, you know, like stories of, you know, like girls with their mom and dad died in a car crash when they're 8 years old, and they lived in a foster home and ran away and moved to LA, or you know, their dad molested them, you know, back in Kansas, so they came out here to get away from the family, or they came here to be famous, or just some, all kinds of weird stories. So I try to get, you know, capture some of that. You know, not everybody wants to put their business out on blast like that. So, you know, I try to get some of the stories, you know, in the LA Woman section. And then because we're down here in Skid Row, you know, we're 10 blocks away from San Julian, which is, to me, the worst street in LA. Like, it doesn't get any worse than that. It was like everything scandalous goes on there. From 5th to 7th on San Julian. It's like, to me, there's not a worse street in LA. So we moved down here in 96 downtown, and we've been down here ever since. So we're in touch with all like the homeless people around here. And I did a series called Skid Row Stories, where I would interview a homeless person every time, or, you know, well, the homeless, either they're a vet, you know, they, something happened to them in Vietnam and they just couldn't deal anymore, or they're like paranoid schizophrenic, or they're drug addicts, or something happened to them to make them come down here. So, you know, we're telling those stories, and then the other one was tattoo stories, which is, you know, we're in the tattoo world. And we just went around to all the tattoo shops that we liked, or we went to people that collected tattoos a lot, you know, like full body suits, we talked to them, and it was fun.
Nice. All right, cool. So two final questions. What's the status on Ink the Movie?
Ink the Movie is a documentary originally, and it was a book. It was a book and a documentary. We did the website in like 2003 or 2002, and at that time we were getting hit up a lot to do reality shows, and we turned them all down, and then they just took off, and they took our name and everything, you know, Miami Ink, New York Ink, Las Vegas Ink, Orange County Ink, Texas Ink, you know, like burned the name out. So we got signed to do a movie off of the documentary, and we changed the name, and we learned at that point like to never put out there what we were doing unless it was out already, because otherwise people would just molest it. They'll take the name from you, or, you know, in this case, it don't matter if it's something that you came up with or not, you know. They'll molest it anyways. Today, I got a thing from Budweiser guess they want to bring you know, they want to have a No Color Lines event or something like that, which is good, you know. Mm-hmm. You gotta increase the peace, stop the violence or whatever. But this is something. It says Made in America Budweiser Music Festival. You ready?
Yeah. Rolling.
We are rolling. Son. There it is. That's Budweiser. Anheuser-Busch. They came up with that all by themselves. How creative. Let's make an LA. And we use an African American and an Anglo-Saxon. Is that what they say, white?
Yeah, basically.
Anyway, black and white. Mm-hmm. Black and white. Black and white. That's the music for us. I guess it's like hip-hop and rock or something. Or I don't get it. I thought music was for everybody.
Right, right.
You know, all nationalities, all colors, all races. Oh, I was talking about all the inks and everything.
That, yeah, I got commercialized.
Yeah, how, like, people, if you put it out there, you know, people will take from you, you know? Mm-hmm. And so we don't really put out our projects that we're doing mm-hmm. until they're done, because
you don't want it.
We don't want somebody to go, oh, that's what they're doing, we need to put it out first, or we have more money than they do, so let's put it out better, then it'll look bigger, and like we came up with it, and it'll look like, you know, they're copying us. So mm-hmm. you know, this was a project that I just did. It's a, you know, called LA Portraits. It's a book about, you know, different portraits that I've done in the neighborhoods here in LA. And that's a sneak preview. Mm-hmm. The rest is online.
Okay.
You can get it at the one-stop shop. And then I'm back to, you know, we got the documentary back from the movie company. Mm-hmm. So I'm out shopping the documentary or different shows that I could do, because basically, like, for photography is like, there's not, unless you're in like full-blown advertising, mm-hmm. you can't really make a living at it solely, you know, mm-hmm. just being a photographer of like hip-hop artists, you know, where you're doing the album covers that are 20,000-30,000, you know, on up to $250,000 budgets. Like, if you can get $10,000 for an album cover now, you're like a god, mm-hmm. you know, in the photography business. But it's hard, you know. I just did Khalees's album cover. I did Kid Ink's album cover and Mad Lib.
Okay.
And, you know, those budgets were like probably a third of what they would have been 5-10 years ago.
Okay.
So right now I'm pretty much shopping different shows.
Okay.
Whether it be like a documentary or a docuseries or a feature movie.
Okay.
And then I just shoot whatever I want, you know. I'm not trying to make a living out of shooting photos anymore.
Okay.
I'm trying to shoot moving, like mm-hmm. film or, you know, some kind of a series.
Right.
Docuseries.
Okay. Do you want to plug your, like, where people can find you online?
Yeah. I got my website, which is EstevanOriol.com, my Facebook, Estevan Oriol, Instagram, Estevan Oriol, and Twitter, I'm Joker Brand, and then I got Estevan Oriol Vimeo and YouTube. And you know, I plan to just everything that I've done so far, I want to, you know, step it up. And I feel like this year is going to be a new, like, I feel like I've been doing what I've been doing for so long one way. This year I'm going to change it up to adapt with the times, mm-hmm. because it's harder now. So I'm going to make it easier on me. I'm going to bring in more people that, you know, to help me. Mm-hmm. Basically, it's, I'm going to get a photo agent, and I'm going to get a, either a commercial agent or a video rep, and, you know, let them do, you know, pound the streets for me a little bit, mm-hmm. so that I just want to focus on the work, you know. Mm-hmm. I just want to show up. Like, the way I've been doing it for the past 20 years is untraditional in the professional world. Like, every professional photographer, probably, like, not every, but I mean, like, a good 75% of the ones that are making a living at it, most likely have a photo agent, mm-hmm. a rep that gets them work. Right. And the same with, you know, the people doing commercials. Like, it's very rare, probably, that someone did it the way I did it. You know, 20 years of grinding this everything myself. But, you know, I think I paid my dues, and I'm ready for, you know, to have some help. I might have to give up, you know, some of the money on the paid jobs, but, you know, somebody's working, they need to get paid. Mm-hmm. So I'm down.
Definitely.
I'm down to get a, you know, a little bit bigger team and try and get some bigger jobs.
Sure.
So that I could do, you know, I like doing the shit I like to do. I love doing jobs, you know, because that gives me the freedom to do what I want to do when I'm not doing the jobs. Because when you're a freelance worker, mm-hmm. freelance photographer, you're unemployed until you get a job, and the jobs are not jobs. It's like a one day job. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, I think I did one job this week. And luckily, it was a good paying job, you know, because sometimes they're not. And sometimes you don't get no jobs, you know, like, I could have easily gone this week without a job. But I called somebody that told me something 3 weeks ago. I called them on Friday, and I did the job Wednesday. I was like, hey, what about that thing you wanted to do? You still want to do it? I go, because this week, you know, I think I got some free time. And they're like, you do? And they go, which day? And I go, which day were you thinking of? And they said, Wednesday. I go, yeah, that's the day. But, like, really, it could have been any day. But the other 4 days, I filled up with, you know, making a plan for next week or organizing shit from, you know, shoots that I was, you know, these type of shoots where I'm just shooting. And I'm organizing, like, the digital stuff and going through old folders of digital photos, you know, because this only holds 17 terabytes. So I gotta go through and pick out, you know, the shots that I don't like and just throw them out. You know, like people closing their eyes, like mid, or like making a face when, like, in between shots. I just, you know, gotta go through different folders and just throw shit out, make room for, you know, the new good stuff.
Got it.